Good evening. Thanks for joining us. My name is Veronica Roy, and I'm here to introduce the speakers and our talk today. Today, we will discuss alcohol in your liver. Our speakers are Dr. Robert S. Brown Jr. and Dr. Akhil Shenoy. Dr. Brown is the professor of medicine in the chief division of gastroenterology and hepatology at Weill Cornell Medicine. And Dr. Akhil Shenoy is the director of transplant psychiatry at Columbia University Medical Center. So today we would like for everyone to participate. The way to participate in questions is that you should submit your questions through the question and answer portion, and we will be able to answer those questions. The question and answer portion is at the bottom of your screen in the lower right-hand corner. So our mission at the Black Liver Health Initiative is to address historic barriers and discover new ways to address these obstacles that plague the Black community. We would like to engage by listening, educating, awareness, and increasing access and advancement to transplant care. The Black Liver Health Initiative is promoting liver health care equity within the Black community. And like I said a moment ago, we are promoting liver healthcare equity within the Black community. So an overview for today's talk, we'll understand that liver is a detoxification machine. We will recognize that alcohol is a toxin, which needs to be metabolized by the liver. We will discuss the limits of safe drinking, and even if you don't have any other risk for liver disease, you should know what safe drinking is. And then we will discuss some treatments for alcohol use disorder. And so I will pass it off to Dr. Brown.
Well, thank you. And I want to thank Veronica and Betsy Verna for organizing this. It is really my pleasure to share a little bit of a background on the liver and then really turn it over to Akhil, who is an expert in alcohol use disorder, who will do the bulk of the lecture, and then I'll be available to ask to answer any questions people have on the medical aspects of alcohol-related liver disease or anything else that you have about your liver. So when we think about the liver is the largest organ in your body. Some people count the skin as an organ, but if you skip the skin, it is the largest organ in your body. It lives right on the right upper quadrant, as we call it in medicine, just under your ribs, behind your ribs and under your lungs, below the diaphragm, goes up and down when you breathe. It weighs about 3 to 4 pounds, and it is comprised of two liver lobes, which can both regenerate, and thousands of liver cells that we call hepatocytes. And each of those hepatocytes carries within it the potential to regenerate the entire organ, which is the one internal organ we have in its body that can regenerate itself from small amounts of remaining tissue. Next. And because the liver is so critical, that is why it can regenerate, because you really cannot live without your liver. And so the liver does many different things. Everything that you eat or put in your mouth ends up going into your intestine, obviously, and from the intestine, all the blood, all the lymph, everything that you eat goes first to your liver. And what does the liver do with that? Well, the first thing it does is it makes sure it belongs. So it protects our body. It's our barrier against bacteria, viruses, and toxins, including alcohol, that might try to harm the rest of our body. And sometimes it has to lay itself down and be injured in that process. It then takes all those building blocks and it makes proteins and sugars and regulates fat and organizes all those little building blocks into the things you need to live your life. And so it both detoxifies the things you don't want and creates the building blocks of your muscle, bones, everything else that you do from the things that you do like. Well, what does it do with the things that you don't like? It generally tries to turn them into bile and excrete them out of your body, where it goes back into the intestine and comes out in your stool. However, if things go wrong, that's when you have chronic liver disease. And obviously, most of your blood volume passes through the liver. And so it is really critical at the regulation of your systemic blood pressure. And when things go amiss, your blood circulation is adversely affected, and people can either develop portal hypertension or high pressure in the liver circulation, or accumulate fluid in ways that is harmful. Next. So now we have to turn our attention to alcohol. Well, most people in America drink. I have an occasional cocktail. Many people do. And many people are heavy drinkers. But why don't all heavy drinkers get liver disease? Well, the answer is part of it is how much you drink. Part of it is what and how much you eat. And then a big part of it is in your genes. So we think of alcohol use disorder or overuse of alcohol, what we used to call alcoholism, as a disease. It is not a habit. It runs in families, and there are both risk factors genetically for alcohol use disorder and for those people who will get liver damage from alcohol use. So you can't assume that just because your friend drinks more than you do, that you might be okay if they're okay. Because you may have a genetic predisposition to be more likely to have an addiction to alcohol, or even at the same amount of alcohol to get liver damage where someone else doesn't. And so people with a family history of addiction or alcohol use disorder have a higher likelihood. And the first thing we have to do as both doctors, caregivers, and family members is recognize if you have someone in your family who has a problem with alcohol, it is not a bad habit. It is a disease. And we should treat people with disease with sympathy and understanding, not with judgment and blame. And trust me, I've been a liver doctor for 25 years. It took me a long time to get to the point where I really recognized alcohol use disorder as a disease rather than a bad habit. But having watched what this does to patients and families, I now recognize that no one would choose to be this way. And once you make that recognition, you will be more sympathetic to your family members. You will be less judgmental with yourself. And you will be able to seek the help that you need from mental health professionals, liver doctors, and if needed, a transplant team. Next. So what happens when we drink alcohol? Well, if we drink below the safe limits, and we'll go into that, we maintain a normal liver. And that's good. Our liver is nice. It's brown. It's happy. But if you drink too much, almost everyone will put fat in the liver. The alcohol gets metabolized, you can think of it, directly into fat, and that fat lives in the liver. And some people, good genetics, other reasons, they can just live with a little bit of fat in their liver and never have a problem. Now, they may have other problems related to alcohol use disorder, and as you'll see, not all deaths due to overuse of alcohol are due to liver disease. It affects all of your body, not to mention putting you at risk for job-related or automobile-related accidents. But some people will just live that way. Or some folks will develop inflammation. So the liver says, something's wrong in here. And the liver gets inflamed. And when the liver gets inflamed, the liver cells die. And we call that necrosis. And when the liver cells die, one of two things can happen. If it happens suddenly, and we call that alcohol-related hepatitis, you can get suddenly sick and become jaundiced and end up in the hospital. But that's pretty rare. What happens more commonly is insidiously, the liver is inflamed, it tries to regenerate, but the liver responds to that low-level inflammation by forming scarring. We call that scarring fibrosis. And you can think of that as the liver trying to isolate those toxins away from the rest of it. But that those nodules that form from these little balls of inflammation and scarring eventually call what we call cirrhosis, which comes from the Latin scirrhus, which means to scar. And once you have those advanced scarring that we call cirrhosis, now you're going to have a problem. You're at risk for liver cancer. Your liver can fail. You may need a liver transplant. Fortunately, if you achieve abstinence from alcohol in time, all of this can reverse. And so that's why early recognition and abstinence and abstinence promotion efforts can save lives if we do it in time. But if we stick our heads in the sand, if we try to ignore it, eventually most people will end up with a problem. Next. So how do we treat patients who present with this acute form of alcohol-related hepatitis? Well, the first thing is we need them to stop drinking. They still can heal with scarring and cirrhosis, but if we can get people to achieve abstinence, we will improve outcome. Nutrition is key. You can imagine when the liver is damaged, we want to give you the building blocks to rebuild your liver, and good nutrition, including both vitamins and calories, will help that. And we have to, many people who are drinking too much are replacing healthy calories with alcohol calories. And we got to shift them back from alcohol calories to healthy calories. And in some patients, we need medications, of which steroids, not the ones that make you muscly, the ones that reduce inflammation may help. And that's why it's so important if you know someone who has a severe alcohol-related injury, they need to get into the hospital to get medical therapy. Next. So how big a problem is this? You know, we think about it, 70% of Americans drink, but many of them don't have a problem. But 5.9% of all global deaths across the entire world are due to alcohol. And that number seems to be increasing. And certainly COVID had its own deaths, but COVID adversely affected all of addiction. Opioid use was up. Alcohol use was up as people were isolated, services were decreased, people were more at risk. And though we make a significant issue about opioid use disorder and opioid overdoses, which make the front page of the New York Times, there hasn't been a year in this country where alcohol-related deaths did not exceed opioid overdose deaths. And so over 88,000 deaths each year due to alcohol, of which half is due to liver disease. The other half is because alcohol affects your whole body. It affects the heart. It affects the brain. It increases your risk of diabetes, pancreatitis. And of course, we can't exclude the death of both the person who drinks and often innocent bystanders and their family when they drink and drive. Next. But I want to have a cocktail. You want to have a cocktail. How much can I drink and be safe? Is Dr. Brown telling me nothing? The answer is no. You can drink safely. And the safe amount depends on whether you're a man or a woman. So unfortunately, there are differences between men and women many differences, but one is in how much we can drink. We men are bigger and we can drink a bit more and still be safe. What you can see is that for women, it's about one drink per day, seven drinks per week, and the risk starts to go up. For men, it's about two drinks per day, 14 drinks per week, and the risk goes up. But it is important to know you can't save all those drinks for Saturday night. Binge drinking is very harmful. So one drink a day is much safer than five on Saturday. Next. So let's try to put this into place with a patient story. So this is a 55-year-old married Black female who's admitted to the hospital with what we call this acute alcohol-associated hepatitis, which is jaundice, perhaps fluid accumulation, very sick. She's seen by the hepatologist, but she was her inflammation is too great, and she's recommended for an urgent liver transplant. 5 years ago, this patient would be denied transplant because we required 6 months of abstinence. But increasingly, we've recognized that that may not be the right situation. She didn't know she had a problem. She understands that she has a long-standing addiction, but she didn't know there was an issue, and she commits to long-term sobriety. She shows an interest in treatment and enters an outpatient rehab program and undergoes transplantation, which is successful, and with ongoing treatment, remains sober. This is a story that we hear over and over, but many of those patients, if they don't get to us, unfortunately, perish in the community. Next.
And here, Dr. Brown, I'm going to take over, but I wanted to say thank you so much for that. I think empathic plea about how this is a big impact on the liver. And thank you, Veronica, for moderating today and bringing the questions that I think people are going to be asking about how this impacts liver disease, how this is going to impact the heart. And I'm going to try to talk a little bit about how it's going to impact the brain. And so I wanted to say also with this case, this female, she was only drinking a bottle of wine a day. And a bottle of wine a day to her wasn't a big deal. It was a shock to her to realize that a bottle was enough to cause this type of acute inflammation and require transplantation. And I think we're hearing, like Dr. Brown says, we're hearing these stories over and over again. So what I want to do is transition. And so you get two sort of topics here for the price of one. We've heard about liver disease. We're going to think about alcohol use disorder as its impact on the body, the brain, as a separate entity. And I wanted to sort of focus on the idea first that this is only getting worse. We are seeing increased amounts of excessive drinking. COVID only made this worse. What you're seeing is the sales of alcohol go through the roof. People talked about toilet paper, food, water. No, the most sold item in America was alcohol. And that was a recent report. You can look that up. I think what we're seeing is the impact on certain populations is going to be worse than others. And I think we're going to have to be mindful of this. So what I'm going to do is take you through some practical steps on how to ask yourself, how to ask your family, how to help reduce this burden on the liver. And even though we're not going to be talking about the heart and the brain specifically as far as impact of alcohol on those organs, because Dr. Brown is correct that the liver is the largest internal organ, but I'm partial to skin. I think skin is really important. So it does weigh a ton more than the liver. So it's important, but I think the alcohol impacts the skin too. But then if you go to number three, the third biggest organ, it's the brain, and alcohol certainly impacts the brain. And you go to number four, is the lung. Not as much there, but then 5, the heart. The heart really suffers from alcohol. So we have to think about all these different parts of our body. But in doing so, simple question to ask yourself, ask your father, your mother, your sibling, your brother, sister, ask your neighbor, how many times in the past year have you had, if it's a male, 5 drinks in a day, if it's a female, 4 drinks in a day? How many times in the past year have they had that? This is just one question that is proven to be a very helpful measure of, is the amount too much? I'm not going to stop with this question, though, because I think this is a good question, but it's not the only question. The other question that's really important, which is absolutely to Dr. Brown's point about impact on the liver, is, do you drink every day? And I think we got to give our body a break, our brain a break, our liver a break, our heart a break. You can't drink every day. And that's where it gets into excessive use. So I think, so this is the definition of binge drinking, 5 for a man, 4 for a woman. So we want to be, once you get into binge drinking, your brain starts to change and it starts to expect more. And that's when tolerance sets in. And we're going to get to that in a second. But these are the questions that we sort of ask. These are simple questions you can ask, you know, even your neighbor. I mean, there's no shame here. How often do you drink? How many drinks do you have when you usually drink, right? When's the last time you had 6? When's the last time you had a 6-pack? Or, you know, these are good questions, because even asking the question helps the person trying to answer the question. It's been shown, actually, just asking will reduce the amount of alcohol the other person consumes. Just asking. Can you imagine that? That's like the cheapest intervention possible. Asking these few questions will actually have impact. So let's not shy away from these types of questions. But you know, you got to know what you're talking about a little bit. So I'm going to share you a little bit insider knowledge. What is a standard drink? You got to be able to know your drinks. So in order to help, you kind of got to get into it a little bit, into the weeds here. And not all drinks are the same. We know that, right? We know that a spirit, whiskey, tequila is stronger than a beer. So it's all by concentration of the alcohol in the system. And now you're looking at a variety of drinks here. They're all got the exact same amount of alcohol in them, but they're different sizes. So you got to know how to do the calculation. Well, there's a neat, I use the word neat. Okay, so there's a really cool tool on this website. It's called Rethinking Drinking at the NIAAA. So if you just type in, you know, NIH and Rethinking Drinking, you'll find this calculator, and you can calculate a bunch of things in there. You can type in, you know, different amounts of things, and it'll spit back the amounts. Do we know how much, for example, a bottle of wine is? How many standard drinks in a bottle of wine? Well, that's 5. 5 is way too much for our lady that came in and needed a liver transplant. And she discovered that in an awful way. But I mean, she's good now. She's healthy and she's doing well now. But did she have to go through that? And I think that's why we're here today. But did you know that a 40-ounce, you know, people tell me, oh, I just have one of those. I have one drink. But it happens to be a 40-ounce of malt liquor, which is a little stronger than the lighter beers. That's 5 as well. That's just 5 right there in one of those bottles. What about a half a pint? Well, those are the little tiny ones. Those are the ones that people hide in their little coats and stuff. That's 5 as well. A half a pint is 5 units. A pint is 10. And we know from Dr. Brown, and for hepatologists who have studied this, that if you drink 10 units, and yes, there's genetics as a factor, but amounts is important. If you drink 10 units in 10 years, the chance that you have irreversible liver damage is pushing beyond 80%. I mean, beyond genetics. I mean, let's forget about, even if you're you're getting irreversible liver damage at that clip. So you want to be able to know how to quantify your drinks. All right, let's move on. So when do I get involved? So I'm trying to teach patients about addiction, and there's different things cause addiction. I mean, one of the most common addiction in America is alcoholism, and we call it now alcohol use disorder. People give it a variety of names, alcohol addiction, or and I think what one of the things is, it doesn't matter what it is. We don't necessarily need to use the label. I'm just sticking it. The neuroscientists just call it addiction. And I think the clinicians, we say alcohol use disorder because it's a behavior or a habit that's maladaptive. And we want to, it doesn't mean it has to be always maladaptive. It can be reorganized, reordered. And that's why we sort of use the word disorder. I like this paradigm that we've been trying to promote, and it's this idea, teaching patients how addiction works is kind of like trying to explain how a car works, right? So there's the ignition switch, there's the accelerator, there's the steering wheel, the brakes, and the navigation system. And I think the brain works similarly. So it's a sort of metaphor for addiction, is that we have different parts of our brain that can modulate different aspects of the addictive process. And I'm going to get more into this in a bit, especially when I get to treatment. But I want you to remember this, this idea that, there's parts of the brain that ignite. There's parts of the brain that help accelerate, or craving, we call it, for alcohol, and there's decision-making parts of the brain that help choose either alcohol or other things. And I think to get to that part where the brain is quite affected by the constant use of alcohol, the front part of the brain, which is really important to our personality, to our well-being, that part of the brain gets affected quite a bit. And it's hard to put the brakes on. It's hard to make decisions. And I think that's the part that gets, it takes a while once the alcohol leaves the system for those parts of the brain to sort of take over again. And so we're constantly seeing people having to adjust, not just externally. People talk about people, places, and things, and adjusting their life and picking up their bags and moving to a new place to get away from the addiction. Well, the addiction's happening right here in the brain. So I think it's tough. It takes a while and patience and a lot of hard work to make these things change. But we'll get to that. I want you guys to learn a little bit about that in a bit. So as a clinician, I use sort of a rubric to make the diagnosis, but there's three really main components to addiction to alcohol. The first two are the physiologic or the bodily effects of alcohol on the brain. At some point we've binged, and at some point the brain says, no, that's not enough. I need more. And that's the tolerance. And then once you take it away, that's the withdrawal. So you want to be able to, part of the addiction of alcohol is staying away, is trying to work through the tolerance and withdrawal in the early stages so that we can get to the other stuff. I think addiction's a lot like, most things in life. There's a behavior and then there's a reward. We do something and we get something for it. And when the reward is good, we lose control. So we start to take more, and we start to convince ourselves that it's okay to take more. We start to then notice, or maybe our family notices, that we need to cut down. So we try to cut down, but we can't. And that's where tolerance and withdrawal come back to bite you. It's like, nope, you can't do it. You can't do it. You're losing control. And so you start to see the effects of losing control. And these are no question, this is part of the frontal lobes of the brain that are getting affected by the chronic use of alcohol. I also sort of look for other negative consequences. I mean, one of the definitions of addiction is that despite horrific things happening, people continue to use. They know it's not good for them, but they keep using it. And so we look for those things too. And then the final thing is number six is craving or compulsion. And people have different types of craving. Some people drink to make themselves feel better. They drink because they're anxious a lot. They drink because they're depressed. They're looking for escape. They drink to sleep. They drink to because they're in pain. So there's so many different types of sensory experiences that lead to craving that we have to address while we're helping people stay in remission. So how do we, and I just wanted to highlight that one part of it, which is there's actually, we'll get to this, but the treatment of alcohol use disorder partly is medication based, and we'll get to that. How do I make the diagnosis? How do my colleagues make it? It is a lot of exploration. It's asking questions non-judgmentally, just trying to figure out, you know, there's no shame, as Dr. Brown said. This is a disorder, and we just need to get to the facts. I think even asking patients to submit to toxicology, it's just about getting the facts. And I think following up with them and ensuring that you're there for them is very important. At the Center for Liver Disease and Transplantation, we take care of people, you know, even if they slip, even if they relapse, that's okay. We wanna make sure that we can help them get back to sobriety. All right, so Dr. Brown mentioned what is safe drinking for the liver. There's a slightly different take on this, which is what is safe drinking for to prevent addiction. So similar, but actually a little bit, it's about binge drinking, more focused. So the more you binge drink, the more you're prone to addiction. And certainly what the exact same numbers he gave about the liver, 7 drinks for females, 14 drinks for males over the week. You push over that amount and you start to get risk of liver disease. I have the same, I think, slide here about liver disease, but I think the same thing applies for risk for alcohol use disorder. I'm gonna rush through a couple of these. I mean, I think some of the questions, and I'd like to hear in the chat, but you know, some of the questions that people ask, why is alcohol considered a depressant? You know, that's something that people ask. What? I feel actually pretty happy when I drink. I feel stimulated. I feel good. Why are you saying it's a depressant? And it's absolutely true. With, you know, lower amounts, you get disinhibited. The frontal lobes get disinhibited and the GABA systems, you know, a bit disinhibited, and you're feeling okay. You're feeling good. You push it a little bit more and you will not feel that way. So that is kind of the sort of conundrum, is the experience that some of us feel because we're not drinking as, you know, more than 2 in an hour. By the way, just keep in mind, if you drink more than 2 units in an hour, your liver is getting overwhelmed. Okay, so 1 unit in an hour, your liver can possibly take it. After that, you're causing damage. So, and it's going to your brain. So it's probably going to lead you to the depressant effect. So, you know, alcohol is not a stimulant, like cocaine, amphetamines, tobacco, caffeine. They're all stimulants. With time, alcohol and amounts, alcohol is certainly depressant. And what we actually see is when people stop drinking, we see the excitement. We see the anxiety, the tension. And this is something we commonly see in the hospital, is helping people get through that first period where they're trying to get the tolerance of alcohol out of their system. They're going through the withdrawal, and we're trying to do it safely. And I think... this is certainly an excitable moment for a few weeks and predicts people going back to drinking. So beyond that time, that short period you're in the hospital, that's not the only addiction treatment that you need. And this is the common folly, is that patients think, okay, I was detoxed, I'm good. And that is absolutely incorrect. First of all, withdrawal symptoms themselves sometimes last much longer than the hospital stay. Then we have something called post-acute withdrawal, which is more subtle symptoms of GABA imbalance in the brain, which has to be stabilized. And so you see relapse actually increase in those few weeks after coming out of the hospital, because people feel so bad from the withdrawal and the post-acute withdrawal, the insomnia, the ongoing anxiety. So you do need to think about a full system. And going back to the brain picture, we think in terms of a medication to reduce the ignition switch, to stop that ignition switch from even occurring, to stop the accelerant of the, you know, the craving for alcohol. We talk about therapy to help with decision-making, groups that help with the sort of another level of support. And then certainly individual therapy and medications for if you're suffering from ongoing anxiety or depression, other types of psychotherapy and psychiatric care to help with the mood and the baseline issues that come up that may predict sort of again back to those old habits. Remembering that, oh, alcohol was there for me. I really wanted that again. We called alcohol the sledgehammer, right? It just takes over everything. And people want that again. And how do you help them forget? Well, it takes a while. The amygdala and the hippocampus are the memory centers of the brain. They have to be readjusted. They have to relearn. They have to find friends in different places. So that all takes a lot of work. And I think important. And I'm going to get to some resources at the end that I think you guys will like. But I think, you know, just to kind of talk about medications, which is in my wheelhouse mostly, is that thinking about there's a lot of medicines now that we use for addiction to alcohol. And if one doesn't work, go to the next one. If that one doesn't work, go to the next one. You shouldn't feel like, okay, I've not seen people go through all of them, because at some point we find something. And if it's not a medication, then we'll get to the other types of treatment, because it is not just about medication. You know, there's so many, alcohol is all around us. It's in the store. You can even order it online. In fact, that's what people were doing during COVID. They were ordering it online. They're getting it delivered. And the increased amount of alcohol sales during COVID, just astronomical, you know, 30% from what it was before, which is already high. We're one of those countries in the world that sells a lot of alcohol, and it's everywhere. So I think one of the things with addiction treatment that I want to sort of hammer here is that one treatment alone doesn't work. So medication by itself, look, sometimes it works, but I think the idea is a variety of different types of treatments together are very, very meaningful. And so what does that mean? It means really matching the treatment program to the individual, right? Thinking in terms of the medicine, thinking in terms of psychological care, and then group support around you. And, you know, I think one of the things that people say is like, oh, AA is not for me. I'm not into that. AA is not the only game in town. And some people are like, oh, I'm not religious, I don't like that. That's fine. There's secular sort of sober support groups. There's a variety of ways that you can find sober support in this country. So, and then, you know, these days now, you know, we had patients in the hospital Zooming and doing AA virtually and other sober groups with people overseas. I mean, they were literally doing groups with people in Europe and in Asia, because that's where the groups were. And maybe it was a language issue. I mean, I had a guy in, I think it was Bulgaria. We didn't have anyone in Bulgarian here. So he, you know, we found some groups in Bulgarian. which was interesting. But I wanted to sort of say is that it's social, it's cultural. I had one of my colleagues at Michigan sent me this Red Table Talk a few months ago. I don't know when it came out, a few months ago. Really nice discussion if you want to keep this conversation going. But the resource at the end, which was the Sober Black Girls Club, which is just a really nice new type of group. Again, people find it, language is a factor, culture is a factor. There are groups there for every sort of group. And I think you have to find it. And I think, you know, from the meeting, we hear Jada Pinkett Smith's mom talk about 30 years in AA, and, you know, and people say, well, I could do AA, but she's like, I did AA and did it for 30 years and it worked for me. But the one thing that she said was that it wasn't the first group. She had to go to the next group. She had to go to the next group. It took her a while to find the group that she liked. And the same thing with a therapist. I mean, there was a match that had to happen. And, you know, you have to, it takes work, but there's a payoff when you find one that helps. And I think that was the sort of the take home message there is you have to find that connection. And so with that, I think we're wrapping up with our sort of the part where I'm talking and Dr. Brown's talking, but I think what we'd like to hear at some point is some questions. So I'm gonna sort of see what questions we have. And I think we had a couple, at least that even from before, and we'll just try to answer them as best as possible.
We have a lot, Eric. I don't know whether you want to read them or we want to have Veronica or Betsy ask them, and we'll just as many as we can.
Okay.
I can read them. I first want to just thank you both for such a robust discussion around liver disease and giving us practical tools and visual representation of what it looks like to drink too much and what is drinking too much and how we can have different resources that pertain to the Black community. And so I think the first question will go to Dr. Shenoy. How can I start a discussion with someone who I think drinks too much?
That's a great question. And I think, you know, I think about my dad, I think about people that in my life that I've had to have some of these discussions with. And I think it's important to, ask, to my mind, those questions about just being empathically curious and wishing to understand how they use alcohol. And I'll just ask those questions like, when you're drinking, how much do you drink? Or do you give yourself a break? Are there days that you step away from it? You don't drink? You know, just the bare bones questions of quantity and frequency are so important just to get the conversation started. And and I don't even go beyond that, because like I said, I mean, you don't have to, because just asking those two questions will help the person reflect a little bit. Now, they may not completely, and they may slow down, or they may say, I don't know, what's your, you know, why are you getting into my business about this? And say, well, I'm just curious. I mean, I'm concerned. And I give story myself, or, this is how much, this is how much someone was drinking, and this is how much they were drinking a bottle of wine. And that was, to them, it seemed like a normal amount. And after reflection, they realized that that's actually a lot more than what is acceptable for your liver to handle on a night. And so they were surprised. And I just wondered if, you know, your amount, you've ever been surprised? Do you know that that's more than is recommended, or more than your liver can handle for a night? And I think I just asked those questions in a sort of, non-judgmental, very sort of without any, you know, I think asking questions like, well, that's, you know, sort of assuming, well, that's a bad habit. Well, that's something you shouldn't be doing. You know, saying those things, I think, push people away. I think saying, this is what I learned at this liver talk. You know, I learned that, you know, more than two drinks a day can actually damage your, or two drinks in an hour can actually damage your liver. And two drinks in a day can have a long-term, have a lasting impact. I mean, these are just things I learned. And I think those are the things that you can kind of share with people so that they can go, okay, well, I actually didn't know that. And I think that's where you can help.
How far is too far with scarring of my liver from alcohol? Does it take a certain number of years? Is this worse for women or men?
That's a great question. And I think your dog was trying to ask the same question. You know, I speak fairly fluent dog. And the answer is that, one, the first part is easy. Yes, it's worse for women than men. And alcohol liver-related liver disease is rising much more rapidly in women than in men, because women have started to drink almost as much as men, and their tolerance of it, both physically and in terms of their health, has decreased. How much damage you can do really varies individual to individual. And as I noticed also in the chat, there are factors beyond genetics. So the amount obviously matters. The genetics matters. Someone mentions, does BMI matter? Remember that there is both alcohol-related and non-alcohol-related fatty liver disease that's related to obesity, which is also rising in the United States, diabetes, high cholesterol. And if you have one of those conditions, which also causes fatty liver disease, sometimes even social amounts of alcohol in the presence of diabetes and obesity can greatly accelerate. So the more you drink, the fewer years it takes. The more other risk factors you have, including gender, genetics, obesity, diabetes, the quicker it takes. So the first thing I could say is that part is unpredictable. Usually, if you're not drinking excessively, it takes decades. But we've had people in trouble in their 20s. The youngest patient that I saw who had life-threatening alcohol-related liver injury was 19. And so it can happen suddenly, it can happen slowly. And we monitor for that by looking for abnormal liver blood tests, for looking for fat in the liver on an ultrasound. And the best way to know is to be checked, because, you know, you can try to ignore it because you're embarrassed or because you feel stigmatized, but the only person who pays the price is you. As I tell all of my patients, it's easy to fool me as your doctor. It's probably reasonably easy, and I'm amazed, to fool your family and your loved ones. But you're not going to fool your liver eventually. It will catch up with you. And so when you look into your soul and you say, I know I need to cut down. I feel annoyed because people are asking me about drinking. I feel guilty. I need a drink in the morning just to get going. Those are what we call the CAGE questionnaires. You should start to think, I need help. Because if you had diabetes, you'd go to a doctor. This is the same seriousness, and it is treatable if we catch it in time.
Yes. I think you might have answered our second question too about BMI and how it processes alcohol in the liver. The next question is for Dr. Shenoy, and it's actually from one of our patients. It says, I am gratefully a NYP liver recipient from 2011. Hearing Dr. Brown's recognition of alcoholism being a disease and not a habit is profoundly powerful. My question is, I live a healthy life with a healthy liver, but coming to terms with the habit versus the disease psychologically can be a struggle. What psychiatric help can you suggest at NYP Cornell, and I'm going to assume Columbia, to help with this part of being a survivor of end-stage liver disease?
Oh, great question. And I think the next couple slides, I was going to have the resources. I think it's important to get those numbers and things down, because we do have, sort of changing your patterns of your life, sort of going back to that model of the maps and the navigation system. Yeah, I mean, we have to sort of reprogram our life, create a new life. And I think part of that is getting help and getting, getting good coaches and therapists people that can support that change in a positive way, I think is good. So I'll have a couple slides at the end, which is actual like numbers and stuff, so you can just kind of maybe screenshot it and just call the numbers.
Sounds good. Dr. Brown, someone is asking, how can I tell if I have liver damage? Is there a test that my doctor can order?
The simplest way is just to have blood tests, routine, what we call liver function tests, or sometimes called hepatic function tests. The blood tests are pretty sensitive to the use of alcohol. And anyone with abnormal liver blood tests, whether your doctor feels they're abnormal enough or not, should get them checked out. Oftentimes I see patients whose doctors and themselves have ignored abnormal liver blood tests for years, because as I said, the most common route to liver damage is not catastrophic. It is slow and steady. And the slow and steady is done with only mildly abnormal blood tests. So the first is awareness that you might have a problem. And then the second is checking of really what I would call routine blood tests.
Sounds good. Akil, you may have mentioned this during your talk, but someone asked the question of what can place someone at risk for alcohol abuse or becoming an alcoholic?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So getting back to that, quantity is a factor. So the binge, the number of drinks in a 2-hour period does pick up your risk, because you're changing your brain at that point. It's saying, I want more. And when you stop it, it says, I want more. So I think that just the quantity is a factor. I think the associations that you're having. So there's a thing in all addiction is that, and this is just as true as gravity is true, is that the brain works by trigger, behavior, response, right? So there's and the response is the reward. So trigger is like, you see it out, you see alcohol, there's associations, right, with it from the past, your memories. The behavior is the drink. And then the reward is the feeling that you have right afterwards, because alcohol has pleasurable, it hits the opioid receptors, it hits the cannabinoid receptors to some degree too. Alcohol goes all over the brain, by the way. It's a tiny, tiny, tiny molecule that just goes everywhere, affects everything. And so, yeah, there's a lot of positive effects, right, in the brain that makes you feel good. And those areas that were really meant for, for endogenous euphoria, right? Like if you have a, you got a raise at work, or you fall in love, those are the things that the endogenous opioids and the endogenous cannabinoid receptors really kind of make and mediate those processes. So, but alcohol makes it happen like that, makes you feel good in a moment. And then you remember, wow, I really had a good time there. That was a really fun experience with those people. I want to do that again. And that's where we say, like, if you have a lot of good positive associations with alcohol, it's hard. You got to break some of those associations. You got to have to find positive experiences without alcohol, and that's the hard work. But I think it's easy to slip back into that, because look, alcohol is an easy thing. It's just it's all around us. Super small molecule, goes everywhere in the brain, affects everything. So it's hard to get it out. It's hard to clean it out.
Thank you, Dr. Shenoy. We have a lot more questions, but I see that we're running short on time. I'm so glad that people were so engaged that they had a lot of questions. I'll wrap up with one question, which I think is a good one because we work in liver transplant. And so the question is, can a liver transplant recipient safely have 2 drinks a day?
The end of that question is, that sounds risky. I agree, that is risky. And right. The reason is, one, probably 2 drinks a day, is at the safe limit. And we don't want to live at the safe limit. And we certainly don't want to live at the safe limit if we've had a liver transplant. But the new liver seems to be, for reasons we don't fully understand, more sensitive to the effects of alcohol. And alcohol affects the levels of the immunosuppressive drugs. It lowers them. And so people are at risk for rejection. And if they stop and start, at risk for both rejection and then having too high levels when they get adjusted. So the answer is, post-transplant, what I tell my patients is the safest amount is none. But if they want to, 1 drink when their child gets christened or at weddings and bar mitzvahs, probably okay. But more than that, you're taking certain risks. And the other thing is, for people with addiction, the only safe thing is to avoid completely. Because what happens is it starts with one, then it becomes 1 a day, then it's 2 a day, and then we have a problem again. And so we can't do that with food addiction because we all have to eat. But fortunately, with substance abuse, whether it's be alcohol, opioids, et cetera, there is an option for complete abstinence, and that is the safest amount.
Absolutely. So Dr. Shenoy, you were going to show a few extra slides as we wrap up. I just want to thank everyone again for participating in this talk. We appreciate your attendance. These are some resources that Dr. Shenoy suggests. Go ahead.
I'm going to try and type answers while you're showing.
Yeah. And so this is our liver, these are our liver clinics. And I think this is important to note that Uptown and Midtown, the main, but there are so many sites all over the tri-state area. Really easy phone number, LiverMD. I don't know how we got that, but that's great. I was going to share a little bit about addiction help because I think part of the talk was about addiction too. And so there's 2 sites here. They're both in Midtown, but they're doing a lot of virtual. So one is the Columbia site on West 51st Street, and the other is the Cornell site on West 45th Street. So the phone numbers are here if you want to take a screenshot, and both of them are taking patients. So I think it's helpful to have that. I mean, and to answer one of the questions, a couple of questions, someone writes, talk about family support. Obviously, of course, family is so important. And that's that inner layer that you want to have. You want to have family, but then, maybe you need a sober support of people that are not family. And so that goes beyond this too. And that can be done virtually, but also in person. And then maybe you need a psychiatrist or you need a therapist. And so here's the resources for those items. So connect with us. And then of course our website, which I think is easier to navigate. So you go to the website and learn more about us. And certainly ask questions and be in touch. So thank you.